So hello and welcome. My name is Udwa Kamimo. I'm moderating this session on the digital economy and what it delivers for Africa. If you want to tweet about this session, please use the hashtag Digital Nairobi. That's hashtag Digital Nairobi. Please use the hashtag TDS Nairobi as well for this and any other session. And you can also tag the sponsors of this session, the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development, using at ICTSD. That's at ICTSD. So this panel is fittingly taking place in Africa's digital capital, Nairobi. And what we're going to do is to separate fact from fiction and then come up with policies, we hope, to help generate better looking facts about Africa's digital economy. We have a distinguished panel drawn from a wide range of perspectives on this issue. We'll start with Ali Mufuruki. He is the chairman and CEO of the Infotech Investment Group Limited of Tanzania. Don't be deceived by Ali's humble demeanor. He has many leadership fellowships to his name, as well as companies founded and board memberships. We have Philip Gitahi. He's the sales head, tax and custom solutions at the TechnoBrain Group. He heads a special business unit that focuses on trade facilitation solutions at TechnoBrain. Before he joined, I believe you were most recently part of a team that delivered 90% growth in revenue collection to one of Kenya's fastest urbanizing county governments. Next up is Arti Shah, the head of government relations Africa at Thomson Reuters. RT leads the firm's engagement with central banks, capital markets regulators, financial intelligence units, ministries, state-funded universities, and other government entities across the region, supporting them with their priorities in the areas of financial sector stability and others. Esther Masharia Chibesa is the head of the Treasury and Trade Solutions East Africa at Citi, covering Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, and Zambia. Under her leadership, Citi's Treasury and Trade Solutions has been at the forefront of the provision of innovative digital solutions in the East African market, such as a fully integrated tax payment module, automated mobile money solutions, and enhanced liquidity management products, which allows clients to centrally manage their treasuries across multiple banks and geographies. And completing our lineup, we have Simon Lacey, a senior expert, trade facilitation and market access at Huawei Technologies in China. But Simon's substantive work, he's the lawyer in the panel, so this is his substantive work, which has covered various areas of international economic law, and he's published and lectured extensively on international trade law and policy, as well as serving on various delegations to the WTO. His current research and professional interests focus on the evolving set of trade and investment rules affecting the digital economy and how governments in developed and developing countries are struggling to find the right balance between openness and regulation when it comes to disruptive technologies and business models. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, this is your panel. So no one challenged me when I said that Nairobi was Africa's digital capital. That's, of course, riding on the back of our M-Pesa fame, the mobile money fame. But according to a report by called the Digital Evolution Index by the MasterCard Foundation and Tufts University in the US, South Africa is actually the most developed digital economy on the continent and one of the fastest growing in the world. But panelists, I come to you, starting with Ali. What is the digital economy? What is digital trade? Is there a difference between the two?
Good afternoon. People must be getting tired of me. I think I've been on this panel now for far too often. And I want to say, although I started out as a tech entrepreneur, as a young person,
would you please, yes.
Some
yes.
28 years ago. The world has moved on quite a bit. The crop of tech entrepreneurs that we have today who are making waves and building companies a completely different kind of DNA and doing exciting stuff that I'm certainly no longer qualified to do. But I'm still involved. I was, for those who come out of Kenya, I'm one of the co-founders of the Zuku cable TV business. I've been chairman of that company the last 5 years. And you've seen how it has transformed the landscape, especially for those of you who are using this service in your homes and offices, and how the connectivity has changed here in Kenya and contributed to making it the digital capital of East Africa. But to get back to your question, what does digital economy mean? I don't know what it actually means. All I know is that we use ICT as a tool to simplify, to quicken processes, and to improve the convenience with which people receive and use services. So if you can use technology to become more efficient, to become more competitive, to become more modern in the way you consume, I think you are probably living that digital economy.
Okay.
I don't know if that's a good answer.
That kind of speaks to the opportunities that digitization brings. But Philip, maybe let me come to you because you're also in a tech company. And I'll add on to the question, digital economy, digital trade, is there a digital Africa? Does it exist or are we just, you know, hyping up a fiction?
Okay. Yes, it exists. As to the opportunity and the, you know, how much growth opportunity lies in there, it's immense. Let's just start by saying, you know, if you think about, you know, the rules of economics, you know, supply and demand. Traditionally in Africa, we are told that agriculture is the main commodity of trade. Even on that level alone, if we could just improve the access to information to be able to raise the level of access to markets, to the farmers, of knowledge to the actual subsistence farmer of where he could sell his produce. Now, we have seen this happening with platforms such as M-Farm, where traders in specific open-air markets, you know, input information on what's happening in the market on a day-to-day basis. But the farmer could be well-informed on what's happening across the border. And therein lies the gap, getting this information to the actual Wanjiko, Mama Mboga, in the farm. So yes, we've built the highways.
And so for our non-Kenyan listeners, you mean to ordinary people?
Yes, to the common,
sort of people
common
in this room.
Yes.
Okay. Your firm, TechnoBrain, your motto is empowering lives.
Yes.
So in terms of innovation, these sorts of innovations that you describe,
yes.
What is your company doing?
Okay, so I'm sure the story was told yesterday, so I won't go too much into it. But one of the major things that TechnoBrain has done is to empower lives. Now, in every country where we are involved, we train young people in ICT skills. We employ local people into the companies in this in the countries where we are present. 19 countries in Africa, with close to 1,400 staff. And in as far as innovation is concerned, we use technologies from our partners to develop in-house innovations to deliver solutions that actually change lives. Access to information. We traditionally have been in the public sector space. For example, one innovation that has transformed some of the local governments here in Kenya is our e-cabinet solution, which helps the local authorities in their cabinet meetings to be able to go through their agendas, to track the decisions that they make, and to be able to measure how effective they are.
What barriers have you faced?
So your questions are coming at me hard and fast.
No, equal opportunity. They'll get hard and fast as well.
Now, some of the barriers have been mentioned before, cross-border tariffs, challenges to accessing finances. Those are the traditional challenges that are mentioned. But I will talk about the elephant in the room, which is corruption. Corruption is a big challenge to doing business, not just to doing ICT business, but to doing business in Africa. And specific to corruption, we find that the procurement acts that were adopted initially by advice from the World Bank, and they were meant to curb corruption, no longer do that. They actually aid corruption. And you find governments procuring solutions at prices that they would not procure even in the West, even in Europe. So these, from a policy perspective, this is a major challenge that needs to be addressed. And Africa needs to find a procurement law that suits it so that it can buy the best at the right price.
Okay. Esther, you work for a multinational. In terms of innovation and obstacles, is your experience similar or dissimilar from Philips?
Thank you for the opportunity. I work for a multinational, Citi, and Citi, we often say is a technology company, actually, with a banking license, more than it actually is a bank, because of the many ways in which we have helped to drive the innovation agenda around the world. And I can demonstrate this just by, you know, giving you a few examples of that. If the global financial markets size is about $156 trillion, Citi moves $2.5 trillion of that on a daily basis. If we bring that into down to Africa, we move about $12 billion every month just within sub-Saharan Africa. And a lot of this is funds related either to trade or alternatively to matters related to trade for our corporate and institutional customers on the continent. And that's a sizable amount of money. It's a GDP for a small, small country. How has our experience in innovation been? Very good. For example, here in the region, we have invested heavily in technology platforms that move about 10 to 15% of the taxes collected in the Eastern Central African region for the government. And that's important because what we've done is helped to close the distance in revenue collection, work with the states to provide further, information to our customers. We have invested heavily in integrating with mobile money solutions, for example. It's a little known fact, but every month we pay 150,000 to 200,000 farmers here in various parts of the country, and we're going to expand that. So we're impacting lives in a material way, and those are just a few examples. Our experience has been positive in the main, and I'll say this because we are finding, first of all, that from a resourcing perspective, we're able to get young people to participate, whether by way of being employees or by way of their ideas. I'll give you an example. We recently, earlier in the year, we had something called the Citi Mobile Challenge, which was a hackathon, a competition that was open to a lot of tech companies in sub-Sahara Africa. We had 700 entrants. Half that number were from Kenya. Eventually, we had one day of demonstrations. 18 out of the 20 selected companies were Kenyan. There were two winners.
So Kenya is the digital capital of Africa.
So there is a lot going on here to prove that it is the digital capital. But what did that experience teach us? We have ideas. We have resources. We have talent. We have systems that people are able to integrate to across the world in order to actually play materially in this space. So we've had an excellent experience here.
What about barriers, though? Because you're painting this very, rosy picture of things.
Yes, and I don't want it to sound utopian. It's just that oftentimes we approach a subject as though nothing works. In fact, there is a lot that is positive going on. There are challenges. For example, earlier we were talking about intellectual property rights, intellectual property laws. One of the things we have to contend with every time we select winners out of these hackathons is who actually owns the IP? How can they register it? How can we make sure that their ideas are protected and used profitably? How can they make money out of that? That is one. The second is that our financial services systems across borders are very different. So, for example, here I might have one or two clearing, I could clear funds using the low-value system, say, once a day. In Zambia, I have four sessions. If I have a company that's playing in those two countries, they are facing two different experiences. the regulatory framework is also different. Some countries have a more mature regulatory framework when it comes to digital innovations or digital activity. Others have no framework at all. So there are many challenges that we face when we play in this space.
Okay. RT, what about you? Because with Thomson Reuters, we know it mainly as a corporate dealing with financial intelligence, but you're also playing in digital innovation. What are some of these innovations you're sharing with the market?
Sure. So I think in terms of global trade, which is what I think this whole week is about, you know, there are perhaps a couple of areas I can touch on. And we speak to a lot of investors investing in Africa and investing in other parts of the world, and that consistently will say, you know, transparency of a land ownership and rule of law are the two critical factors that they'll look at before they make an investment decision. So on the land side, you know, we have in countries like Nigeria, so Cross River State, Plateau State in Nigeria, in Uganda next door, you know, Thomson Reuters has provided the cadastre and land registry solutions, which is giving transparency of land ownership. In Cross River, you can get a certificate of occupancy, i.e. a title, within a month, which then allows you to make investments, get investments. You can go and get a loan, for example. And the flip side of it is on the valuations and property tax. You know, City of Cape Town, through, again, our technology, gets 24% of its operating budget through property tax. And they do their valuations using computers. And you know, we're trying to convince other countries in Africa that it's okay to use computers, too, to do valuations. And the impact on that isn't just financial, it's also the impact on society. So in Cape Town, for example, they've rerouted the buses on the back of valuations data. Yeah, if you've got a water leak in your house and it's worth under $25,000, they'll come and repair it for free. So it really does have tangible impacts. And I think on the rule of law, just very briefly, you know, I was speaking to the high courts in Kenya, and they said, you know, an average case takes 3.8 years to clear. And I know from talking to my fellow panelists earlier, there are cases that have been around for much longer than that. And again, what we're trying to introduce is technology to move cases along, bring that transparency about.
So are you working with the judiciary here at the moment?
We're trying to.
Yeah. You're trying to. Okay. excellent. But barriers, though, because like Esther, you're also operating across borders.
Yeah.
Are the challenges the same across borders, or the challenges you find in one country mimic the next country?
I think, you know, one of the challenges that's probably that we find in many countries is the political will to bring about the change. You know, so if you really do want the kinds of transparency I'm talking about, then if you've got government policies and legislation that enable that, then that doesn't mean your troubles are over, but it's one big hurdle that you've crossed. And I think, you know, we come across many countries where that political will is very evident, and then we come across places where it's easy to talk, but action is perhaps less visible.
Okay. Simon, we come to you because Huawei is involved in plenty of innovation. I think that was part of the theme of the recently concluded China-Africa meeting that took place in South Africa. But you're also a lawyer. So in terms of the innovation as well as the legal environment for this, we've heard about intellectual property, we've heard about corruption. How do you balance the two?
Well, I think if you talking about Huawei as an innovation company, and this is something that our founder, Mr. Ren, sort of hammers into us quite consistently, is that we work and we operate in a sector where companies are constantly coming and going. We hire a lot of guys from Ericsson, a lot of guys from Nokia, companies that dominated the devices landscape 10 years ago and which now are all but non-existent. And so we channel a lot of our revenue back into R&D, and we like to really focus on research and development, but also saying that we are a company that puts a huge emphasis on innovation. Now, a lot of that innovation in the company's earlier history was on optimizing existing sort of copper-based infrastructure for the backbone infrastructure of internet connectivity, wherever that may be, in Europe or in Africa. And now, increasingly, a lot of that innovation is focusing on things like smart city solution in our enterprises business, or on providing better smartphones or smartphones that can successfully take on the market leaders like Samsung and Apple. So one of the things that was in the tech press in the last 2 weeks was about a new battery that Huawei has come up with that will come up to a 50% of its charge in about 5 minutes, and that would be quite revolutionary, especially if you take that battery technology and think about some of the other applications. In terms of opportunities for Huawei, I mean, Africa was one of the first places that Huawei really managed to establish itself internationally. Its first international contract was actually Hong Kong in 1996 when it was still under British rule. But right after that, it moved on to Russia and then really rolled out in Africa. And Huawei was able to bring a lot of its experiences in rural China, because it started out focusing on markets in China that nobody else wanted. And it really became an expert in providing rural connectivity. It took some of those lessons to Africa and really built the backbone infrastructure across many African countries. And today the opportunities for Huawei, I've noticed across the road there's this, at the top of this tower there's this big Samsung sign. Samsung definitely
International Conference Center.
seems to be the dominant player here, but Huawei is taking on Samsung and other smartphone providers, and that's really where the opportunities stand
Then to the environment, given your legal background, the challenges like intellectual property, the challenges like the regulatory environment, the challenges of corruption. What is Huawei's experience and what can you offer to people who are still grappling with those challenges?
Well, I think one of the big issues these are very, IP and rule of law, these are very important issues, obviously, but one of the big things we struggle with is we try to identify when we can see a country is moving towards an industrial policy that might not be too beneficial to our business models, particularly not so much data localization, but local content requirements or the helping to establish a local ICT industry. Those things, although we're very supportive of those and we partner with local industry, they can be very dangerous to our business model when governments start insisting on 70% local content if we want to sell smartphones in that market, which is something that Indonesia and Brazil are moving towards, right? That hasn't been such a problem in Africa so much yet, but these are legal policy issues that we identify.
But that comes from a company perspective, though, isn't it? Whereas the locals would see the government to be protecting their interests.
Not if there's no domestic industry or capacity there. I mean, the government's trying to pull something out of thin air that doesn't really exist, right? I mean, technology requires ecosystems. I mean, if you look at how Silicon Valley evolved, or even how the ecosystem around Shenzhen evolved, it wasn't necessarily because of any government planning or any government-driven kind of industrial policy. It was Silicon Valley was just, you know, a conducive environment, a bunch of smart guys who started making computers out of their garages, and that's how it evolved.
Okay, Esther?
Yeah, just to add to what Simon is saying, you know, Part of the role of any player in a digital economy is to find a way to participate productively in the conversation. And earlier you had asked, what is a digital economy? And, you know, that term was coined, I believe, in 1995. But
is it Al Gore? Because
yeah.
He did everything.
Yes.
He invented the internet.
But I guess the point I'm trying to make is, a lot of the laws that exist today didn't exist at the time that, you know, a lot of this technology-driven innovation was beginning to really, really transform all of our lives in whatever way, shape, and form. I can give an example of how we participated in the development of laws that help the mobile money cause. So when mobile money initially started, there wasn't a single law that existed in this country or in any other part of the region that suggested what we should do and how the ecosystem should work and what the players should be doing and whose roles and responsibilities, what those are. So one of the ways we have worked productively as a bank or as a banking organization is to work with the regulators, the central banks, the financial intelligence units, you know, those who have an interest in things like anti-money laundering, et cetera, to try and figure out what would a framework look like. and then to progress that into how would directives work, and then to progress that into, say, industry forums like the bankers' associations, the payment systems associations, what have you, so that you can actually end up with some kind of laws. So it's true that laws can be a challenge, but sometimes the promulgation of them has to start literally from the grassroots. And in a sense, that's also innovation of the legal framework.
Ali, I'll come to Ali. What's your what's your perspective?
Look, I think the positive things have been spoken about. There is a lot happening in Africa. I'm going to focus on the challenges that, if resolved, could translate into opportunities for the digital economy in Africa. And these are around governments. African governments have not been quick at understanding or grasping the importance of the digital economy and how they can play a facilitative role in helping move this revolution forward and make sure it benefits many people.
Not just African governments, governments all over the world, I think, are two or three steps behind.
I think that in Africa, because we take pride in being the most connected continent, and we are the country that innovated or at least deployed mobile money, and we are going to have generations of Africans who maybe will never need to have a credit card or debit card or even a bank account because their financial transactions are going to be managed the banks are already playing that space, so I think they're not losing out. But we many people don't need to open a bank account today. They can pay for almost everything. Merchants are catching on and making it possible to buy almost anything you want using mobile money. But our governments have been extremely slow in terms of recognizing the importance that this ICT is going to play in our lives. Their e-government adaptation has also been extremely slow. Most African governments, I don't think there's a single African government that has even cyber laws that allow prosecutors, judges, and police, for example, to do their work and be able to, for example, in a court of law, tender evidence. There's a lot of cybercrime that's happening today.
I think Uganda is trying that.
Yeah, but I haven't seen any serious legislation or legislative effort, because our members of parliament don't understand, our judges don't understand, our prosecutors don't understand, our ministers responsible for these sectors most of the time don't understand.
But is that then a failure of the industry?
It probably is. It's because if you look at the players, the real local players in the ICT business are actually small. You have few ones like TechnoBrain, but the innovators are the small guys who are participating in a hackathon, who are developing apps, and later not being able to develop them further because there's nobody to buy them, nobody take them up. They have to wait for Microsoft or some other guy from out there to come and buy them, or Citibank, and that becomes the end of the road. Now, why is this the case? Having a patent office in Africa to do the work that patent offices do is not easy. Apart from having the human capacity to do it, there's a lot of financial resources required. Where is the industry that is going to feed or produce the revenues that are going to help run such an office infrastructure in government? I want to compare Africa today to maybe the West Coast of the United States back in the 60s or the early 60s, where you had entrepreneurs or people who in universities that had this command of technology that was on the verge of exploding. But what happened in the United States is that they created something, I read an article somewhere, called the Demand Mountain. And this was driven by government, where the government, after Kennedy said, we want to put a man in space on the moon in 10 years' time. But for this to happen, we have to have faster computers. That was how the techies translated this. We have to have faster computers, faster processors, the big transistor computers that become smaller and faster. And they challenge the entrepreneurs, the innovators. Do this, and we will pay you even for half-baked solutions. As long as it takes us towards that goal, the government provided money. And they challenged the entrepreneurs. And the entrepreneurs started working on those. And the venture capitalists saw the opportunity. And they took risks on some of those innovators. And today you have the Intel guys evolve from that revolution, the IBM, the other people who innovated. Here in Africa, we have solutions, we have problems that African governments need to solve. They could create the same demand mountain. they could provide a market opportunity for entrepreneurs.
So let's turn that around, because we're highlighting the problems. Yeah. How do we address that through policy?
I think it's just understanding that this is not just a lose-lose situation. When African governments put $50 million, for example, in Tanzania recently, and say we are going to pay people for IT business competitions, and it ends there. So kids come and develop over 3 months, 6 months in an incubator, apps, and they get paid for doing something, but they never are taken up by an industry because no industry ecosystem is being built. We don't have venture capital. We don't have private capital here to invest in those ideas and scale them.
Okay. But I'm not sure. Been trying to come in.
So
yes?
The market maker is government, and the market is not and the government is not playing its role.
Okay. I think, you know, I've thought a lot about this in the last few months. I mean, what role does government play? And you know, in preparing for this panel, we were asked to sort of formulate some ideas on that. And I think, look, I mean, the typical textbook answer is, you know, if governments want more of something, they can subsidize it. If they want less of something, they can tax it. But I think One of the approaches should also be governments can actually just get out of the way and let these sectors develop without having to regulate for the sake of
regulation
itself.
Sorry, can I just say something? I forgot to say this at the beginning. Housekeeping, could you please put your phones on silent just so you don't interrupt the audio or distract us, because it's actually quite distracting. Thank you.
Esther was talking before. Citibank's a great bank, by the way. I've banked with them in Citi in Singapore. And I think you should actually try and hire a couple of the guys that won those hackathons. You should try and get them on the payroll. Okay, but you were talking before about, you know, how governments are behind in enacting laws, and you know, if you look at the example of M-Pesa, I mean, one of the reasons why M-Pesa succeeded was because the financial regulator wasn't really sure how to deal with it and just sort of let it proceed in, on an experimental basis without taking a decision on whether or not to allow it. And if you look, Kenya is really way ahead of the rest of the world. I mean, they have mobile, they have online payment systems in Japan. We have one in China that works quite well. I'm on Apple Pay. I think it sucks. It doesn't really work. And one of the reasons why we haven't achieved online or mobile payments in any other country to the extent that we have in Kenya is because regulators are getting in the way. And quite frankly, big banks and card issuers have,
so your
have
point
captured
is government,
regulators.
Government should get out of the way. Arti?
I think one place where government can play a role is, and getting back to this point about intellectual property, you know, today people can't use it as collateral. And I think one, I'm not going to try and simplify it too much, but a relatively quick win would be to get central banks to change regulations, to get the legislation changed such that people can go out and get a loan on the back of their IP. That's not happening today.
So let me just butt in here, you know, and probably put it into the perspective of the IT developer who walks in, I mean, the 22-year-old walks into a business incubator, and he comes up with an idea, develops an app. And this app has great business potential. But he's told, because he has been given the resources to develop this app, he doesn't own it. Or he's told the idea doesn't make any sense. And a couple of business people take the app and build a business around it. Who protects this young developer? Who protects our youth who are so innovative and have their ideas, but they are losing out on their own innovations? This is a major problem, and that's why, from a legislative perspective, the bare minimum of protecting the IP is something that is really important in growing the digital economy. And let me just also add on the issue of on the issue of the actual industry itself. From an industry perspective, we also need to come to the table and start talking convergence. I think we need to get over this psychophancy of only one mobile money system works. All of them works. Technology works. We need to come to the table and offer value to the actual citizen of Africa by allowing them to trade on whatever platform that they are on. It doesn't have to be only one mobile money provider. And it doesn't have to be that because it's a mobile money provider that they're not integrated with the banks. And it doesn't have to be that because I don't have a mobile money account, then I cannot use my Visa, Master, or my debit card. We really need to offer Africans the best value of technology and be as innovative as we have been in the last couple of years, instead of stifling this kind of development.
Esther, then I'll come to Ali, because Ali, something provoked you.
Yeah. The question is what is it that can be done, right, to promote or to help this ecosystem to grow? And there are practical things. One is obviously to figure out what to do with IP law. But the other is to create the kind of environment that enables further investment in. And I'll give you a few examples. For example, we, Citi, have several innovation labs across the world. One of them was set up precisely because the government, I believe it was the Irish government, had very good tax laws around, you know, set up some tech businesses here. You know, we will give you several tax breaks. You can bring in jobs. You can create employment. You can create new products. You can create new types of financial services. So we rely heavily, for example, on the lab that is in Ireland in order to drive a lot of the ideas that we generate in our African businesses, for example. So we generate them. We work with the techies that are out there. And the solutions that we provide are then used to power whatever is going on within our African markets. That's one way. The other is figuring out how can we fund some of these things. So Citi has something called Citi Ventures. This is a fund that provides money in order to bring ideas such as, you know, ideas, startup ideas up to the point where they can become, you know, real business solutions. We have accelerator programs since 2013. In fact, we were the first financial services institution to do this. And we have 33 companies that have passed through that particular accelerator program and become in and of themselves viable businesses. And all of this is done because we have been able to engage usefully with the governments in the countries in which we run these funds, these programs, in order to actually deliver these kinds of things. So it's true that government can do things around laws, but government can also be a huge enabler for the private sector to itself continue to power the digital economy to grow.
So you and Philip are making the same point. Ali, what were you going to say?
Look, what Citi is doing, I think, is very commendable, and I think it's the right way for private sector to engage in this particular industry, in this part of the world. It's the right way to empower the innovators in this part of the world, because you see, developing Africa or developing Africans is not Citi's core business. It's not my core business as a private sector individual. I do business to make money for my company. If I can spare some of those resources to a social responsibility to help others and so on to come along, that is fine. But there is one entity in every country whose job is that, whose core business is that. It's the government, right? Now, look at African governments and the way they view IT. You say you want to provide, you want to transform government, and you want to run a very powerful e-government platform for delivering government services in healthcare, in education, in infrastructure service delivery, in elections, everything. This is a huge, monumental, multi-billion dollar project for every African government. There are two ways of going there. You can go to that vision by floating tenders and asking multinational companies to come and scope out and give you quotations on how they are going to do it for you. Or you can actually have faith in your local innovators, because this knowledge is distributed now. This knowledge is no longer just resident in the United States or in the West or North. It's also resident in the East, in the South. You can trust in your local innovators and say, in 20 years' time, this is where we want to be. Every year, we are going to spend money on transforming this and that part of government, from the current manual systems to ICT-driven systems. We are challenging you to compete and provide the technology platforms. We are going to spend the money. We are going to finance some failures, but we are going to get there. So in the process, you actually help build an industry as you get to that vision, because government spends taxpayers' money. And by innovating and transforming the way it works, it's going to spend less, more effectively, but it will carry along the creation of an industry. I believe there is no ICT industry that has risen. Look, everybody says, where did the ICT in the United States come from? The Ministry of Defense. Where did all those patents come from? They were given by the United States government to innovators to develop, to the innovators to build on. What are our governments doing?
The government has incredible power to push this industry forward. The innovators are already there, but if we want to just make them the poor programmers like we have in India or elsewhere, then they are going to be just poor programmers. But you're not going to have an ICT kind of industry developing in Africa.
This is what one of the local innovators here in Kenya said, that digital technologies are bringing down the cost of information and financial services across the board, which you all agree on. But we can see that Bitcoin is reducing the cost of remittances. Easy access to the internet is changing the way people consume information. Cheaper smartphones mean more Africans have access to information and the internet than at any other time. That would be you, Simon. Digital technology is making it easier for homes to move away from kerosene lamps to solar, M-Copper. M-Pesa accounts for 25% of the GDP in Kenya. It also makes it easier to produce information content technology, and that comes into the media space. Ali, your experience with Zuku, Wanainchi. But there's also something that you haven't quite mentioned, tax. The innovator agrees with you about IP laws and government, poor adjudication, slow, inefficient. But what about tax? The fact that all these innovations are poorly and sometimes heavily taxed.
Lack of understanding by governments. One of my companies yesterday received a big tax bill for where we are being challenged by the tax authorities because we are using IT services rendered by a company based in Dubai and a company based in South Africa to help manage our Oracle database engine for our retail businesses. So we should add the cost. The money that we pay to these companies should be added to the cost of merchandise and taxed as having we underpaid import duties on our goods. And I said, this is insane. What are you talking about? By using these services, we are becoming cheaper, faster, and our goods are reaching our customer at a lower price. Now you want to make them even more expensive. We paid all our taxes. Though we have to go to arbitration on this one issue. But what I see is not somebody being really malicious, but actually a government bureaucrat not understanding what that this is supposed to be. So understanding IT and its benefit and what it can do for our economies is a problem for government officials also. So as I said, they are slow in catching up. They are slow in understanding how important a role ICT can play in pushing our economies forward.
Artie, and then I'll go to the floor.
I think the flip side is we're encouraging revenue authorities up and down the continent to use data and to use technology. And in fact, Kenya Revenue Authority, you may not believe it, is one of the more progressive ones when it comes to transfer pricing. And so transfer pricing is, I'll give a very quick example. If you are manufacturing or assembling something in Kenya, but you're buying some of the parts from overseas from your parent company, then the parent company might say, I'm going to sell you this engine for $1 when in fact it's worth $5,000, right? And that's where once Kenya Revenue Authority or their peers across the continent start having this kind of data, they can actually turn around to that company and say, you owe us more money, as opposed to what's been happening in the past where they go aggressively into the small and medium-sized enterprises and say, we think you owe us money and we're really intimidating and we're gonna charge you anyway. And okay. Then there's all the corruption, et cetera, et cetera.
So we've identified a couple of critical drivers for the digital economy to thrive. In fact, a report by E15, which is involved in all of this, says that in its report on the new digital trade agenda, says that the internet can grow international trade, right? But I'm not hearing, there's a multinational perspective. But Ali, you seem to be getting burned when in your attempts at international digital trade. Is that my understanding of what you said? Is that correct?
Importation of ICT services. We are now having to fight this fight of definition. What is it? Is it a good? Is it a service? Are we paying import duty on it? Are we paying withholding tax on it? What exactly are we paying? Is it an import? Is it an export? For me, it's easy to understand that actually, because of it, I'm paying more money to the government by way of taxes like VAT and so on, because I'm more efficient, I do bigger business than if I was trying to do this manually or use a crappy system. But the tax authorities don't seem to appreciate that. That is, for example, but there is no doubt that if I were to put on my trademark hat now, say,
the
cargo tracking system that we are using now, how it has made it easier for importers of goods to monitor their cargo, the safety of their cargo, the savings they make on transportation costs. Drivers can now not just park somewhere and have good fun for 2 days and claim that the border is closed or the IT systems are down, because the importer can actually see the movement of the truck on the screen on their computer. Is that a system that we have given to the logistics platform in this region, to the tax authorities in this region, and it's transforming our business. So security of goods, security of persons, security of fleets. I think that the benefits that we get from this technologies are almost limitless, but we are not leveraging them enough. But for me, I was concerned about the ability of Africa to actually build a viable industry the way that China has, the way that the West has been able to do, because this is the industry of the future. The industry of the future is not manufacturing apparel. People are going to be digital printing clothes. They are going to start digital printing of jackets. So we have to be going into that area, and we have to be not just consumers. The problem with us is that we are becoming more consumers of everything, including M-Pesa, not the creators of M-Pesa. We shouldn't forget that.
That's a but powerful challenge.
It just sounds like when Ali talks about his vision for getting government involved in promoting this sector, it just sounds to me like he's asking government to pick winners. And
no, not at all.
Okay.
I don't know if the U.S. picked winners. I don't know why Intel emerged as the biggest producer of
microphone, please.
Maybe they were picked. I don't know. Mm-hmm. But you have to enable the industry by removing the obstacles that the U.S. government did. I mean, the U.S. government is a good model to follow.
Okay.
Why
thank you.
The U.S. government is the most advanced in this particular area. Why can't we follow the example?
Thank you. So
because of less regulation, not because of more, though.
Right.
Let's give the audience the opportunity to engage with your collective wisdom here. Questions? Oh, wow. Okay. Let's come to this side, and then I'll come to you. Okay? Yes.
Thank you. I'm George Mngao Konji from the Civil Society. In the interest of digital economy, the year 2002, Kenya government came up with a concept known as Integrated Financial Management System.
IFMIS.
This IFMIS was a failure when it was launched in the year 2004. It did not work. They launched it again 2006. It did not work. But right now, it has been forced down to people to work on it. Now, as experts in ICT, now I'm asking this question to Esther and Gitahi, as patriotic Kenyans and whatever.
Okay, yes.
Yeah. What is your take on that? Because IFMIS has proved to be a failure.
From your point of view, thank you. Next question. There's some, yes. Please, the gentleman in the yellow shirt.
Thank you. My name is Joseph from Data Center Training and Consultancy here in Nairobi. Okay. Mine is not very far from what the gentleman has just been mentioning. I'm not talking about the failures, but being a Kenyan, I'll address my question to the Kenyans. Now, there's this issue we could talk about. In our system, we talk about the implementation. And there are various systems, like the gentleman has just mentioned, that have been implemented. Many have gone through, and many have gotten lapses here and there. And
please ask your question, okay, just so we can get as many questions as possible.
Thank you. I'm about to come to it. Okay, in 2008, I managed to visit Uganda, and they had a mobile system that could actually had a GIS, that's a geographical information system, whereby wherever you could be standing, you could relocate the place, and you could not even ask where you are and what you are, where you want to go. Whenever you knew the direction, you just move, then you'll get the application telling you exactly where you are. The same was introduced in Kenya in 2010. And then all of a sudden, it was not implemented and it never went. We don't know where it went, actually. I just wanted to know what befell the system. Then maybe pulling...
Sorry, that's fine. Just so we can have other people...
Just the same.
No.
Okay.
Pass the microphone over. Thank you.
Mine is going to be brief. My name is Tabu Charles Bungala, as the Lendo chairman. My question goes to us the aspect of this digital economy and digital capital issues. And I think as Africans, we are consumers. What are the environmental risk protection we are taking towards these components we are importing? Because most of them, we are not manufacturers of these things. We normally just consume, and as an M-Pesa, we send. But you see, I concur with Ali yesterday. He's talking about the M-Pesa was an aspect of sending, but you see, you don't make it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's answer that, if we can, as quickly as possible, because there's several hands up, and then we'll come back to the audience for more. Esther and Philip, two sets of questions for you. IFMIS and GPS, something to do with lapses in the government's ICT procurement.
Okay, I must admit that I do not know about this GPS matter, so I'm not going to give an answer because I'm not going to pretend to know it. But on IFMIS and on systems in general, right, any system, the idea of introducing a system in order to produce transparency and better information and better controls is in and of itself a good idea. And we do this often, even with our corporates. IFMIS is a system that is, it is an instance of SAP, okay? However, any system not properly supervised or controlled or audited is fraught to misuse, right? And so in that sense, and I'm not commenting about the government, I'm saying any system that isn't itself properly taken care of, looked at, implemented well, tracked, frequently audited, can be misused. So I would beg that we divorce the matter of the system from the matter of governance. And this has less to do with a system in and of itself and one of how to do governance around risks and controls. And these risks exist whether or not you're a government or you're a corporate or some other kind of institution.
Philip?
So the easy question is the one of GIS. Even right now, your phone is giving out information of your exact location. So the service exists. The question is how you consume it. Right now, you can get a GPRS app. It'll be able to tell you exactly where you are, where you want to go. On IFMIS, a lot has been said. There's the political aspect. I will speak from purely from a technology aspect. Technology, for technology's sake, does not solve any problem. Technology is implemented to assist people to be able to achieve a specific function. Now, one of the challenges from a technology perspective of any implementation is the processes that you are automating. If you automate bad processes, then what you are doing is you're automating inefficiency. So the first step is to review the processes, which, if you know, was done most recently, I think, between 2009 and about 2012, thereabouts. So they finally got it right, and they reviewed the processes, and they re-engineered the processes, and then brought the technology implementation after. Initially, they started the wrong way around. It is not something about government. It has nothing specific to do with the Kenya government. These mistakes have been made in the technology world over and over again, but today, people realize that change management is something that is very important. Inclusion and bringing in the user adaptation, these are things that are very important. So you must first speak to the people who are going to consume the solution and get them involved, get them to buy in, get them to own the system before you actually give it to them to consume.
RT, you want to come in?
Yeah, I mean, I think I agree entirely with what you've just said. We spend a lot of time with, going back to judiciaries, who receive documents from consultants with 900 requirements building the Rolls-Royce of a court case management system when they've never actually spoken to a judge. And we spend a lot of time discouraging judiciaries from doing that, both in the region, but, you know, the UK government threw away £200 million on a failed e-filing and case management system because nobody had spoken to a judge. And we can't even afford to do that in this part of the world. And that's what, you know, that's what we say consistently to the judiciaries we speak to. Involve your judges, involve your stakeholders.
Okay, Simon, I'll bring you in because there's a specific question about environmental risk protection. And I'm hoping that through your legal background, you can address that.
Yeah, I wasn't actually sure what the question was asking. So is it asking what is the potentially dangerous environmental impact of importing all of these ICT goods that are not manufactured here? Is that what you were getting at? The environmental impact.
Yes.
Right. Yeah, I saw something very interesting about this on Al Jazeera because Africa imports a lot of used computers. Right, sort of secondhand desktops and that sort of thing, but there is no sort of national agency for reviewing whether or not these products are actually safe. And what happens is these products also get disposed of. Now in the West, in industrial countries, these products get disposed of in a very careful way because their components are potentially dangerous, and that doesn't happen in Africa.
So, for those that know how to handle those old computers, some of them had gold in them, some of them have aluminium in them. They are reusable metals if you know how to recycle them. So it's about us also being proactive enough to get the information we need on how we can recycle these materials.
Okay.
In places like China and Japan, they're thrown out of the window.
Okay. More questions? Okay, we'll come back to that. Yes?
Okay, I am Dr. Asfore. I'm the chair for the Human Resource Science and Technology Cluster of the African Union ECOSOC. Also the chair for Commercial Business Council. I really thank you all for your presentation. This session is about digital economy for delivers for Africa. How do you think we bridge the gap? There is a lot actually of stakeholders here. At African Union, we deal with the 54 countries in Africa, with the civil society organization to empower the youth and the women to have access to this ICT technology. The private sector is mainly about making profit, and especially the multinational companies, as you just said now. How can we really, all the government, the platform, last week in Egypt, we organized the African Congress for Science, Technology, Innovation, and Entrepreneurship. It's about how the digital economy could have an impact on the daily life of African people, starting from the grassroots women and then the youth who have innovation and they don't have, of course, finance
okay.
for your innovations. And also for COMESA, for instance, a truck which is going from Cairo to Sudan to Ethiopia with all our e-customs. How can we bridge this gap among the governments, the civil society, the business community to have a platform to empower the youth when they have innovation to finance them?
Okay, thank you. Let's leave it at that. There's a question on this side of the room. Yes, please stand up so they can see you.
Thank you. My name is Wainaina Dereba Mwangi. I wanted to ask, I've been interacting with the young mobile apps developers, and the challenge they have been having is how to cost or price their product. What is the institutional guidance from the panelists that you can give this member? Do you cost your app based on the number of hours that you have taken to build it, or do you cost it based on the perceived revenue for the corporate you are trying to develop the app for?
Okay, that's a very good question. Thank you. And there's a third question. Please stand so they can see you.
Good evening. My name is Antipas Sakala. My question goes to West. I think you touched on IP laws, and you agree that our IP laws are weak. There's this perception that most of these big players in private sector are happy with the weak laws because they can easily get those innovations at a cheap price. I wanted to know what is private sector doing to ensure those laws are changed so that they can be able to encourage innovators?
The lady at the back, I'll take your question. Stand up, please. Lady, yes, you. Who's standing? Yes.
Thank you. I'm Elizabeth Wachvinga Gaswaga, legal advisor, rule of law with the Commonwealth Secretariat. A study that the Secretariat is conducting with UNCTAD has revealed that on the African continent, data protection laws are next to absent. I think a few countries, like in the East African community, have draft bills, but they've not gone through the process. And in light of the relevance of transfer of personal information in regard to trade and development, cross-border flows, restrictions from the EU.
Sorry, please ask the question. I'm trying to get as many people to, yes.
What is the private sector doing? What are the stakeholders doing to ensure that data protection laws on the continent are put in place to support digital trade?
Thank you. We have just about 20 minutes to go. I don't know how quickly you can answer these questions, but they're all linked, which is the beauty of them. So bridging the gap between business, government, civil society. Philip, that sounds like something for you because it's a private company, but it's also in the social space. And then costing, pricing of apps. Ali, you seem to be smiling, so we'll throw that one at you. And then Esther. Esther, IP laws, weak laws, which, you know, make the private sector happy. Data laws are weak. Maybe, Simon, you can address that. Let's go.
Thanks, Udwak. On the two questions that were asked by the chair from COMESA, I think the first and most basic thing that we are asking for is a change in legal policy across African nations on the protection of intellectual property that is being generated from innovation. And I think the second would be to ask these economies to support innovators either through subsidies or by relooking at how they actually tax these kind of digital innovations. I mean, we've got technological solutions and apps that have been developed on the continent. I mean, look at OLX, for example. I mean, coming out of Nigeria. We've got Jumuiya right here in Kenya, where, you know, most Kenyans know if you want to buy a phone cheaper than the shop, you order on Jumuiya. It gets delivered to your office and you can pay.
For the non-Kenyans and non-Africans, both OLX and Jumuiya are online marketplaces.
Yes. They're e-commerce platform solutions. And you go online and shop, and you can actually pay when the good is delivered to you. But how are these businesses being nurtured and being given impetus from a government perspective to grow? So I hope I have given you two key things that we would ask for from an ICT perspective that you could take to the negotiation table with the COMESA state. Number two, you specifically talked about tracking of cargo. In Northern Africa. I'm inviting all of you. We have a cocktail sponsored by Technobrain immediately after this. One of the things we'll be showcasing is one of our innovations, which is in use here in Eastern Africa, in Tanzania, in Kenya, in Uganda, which is an electronic cargo tracking system where you can see where your cargo is at any specific time.
Bridging the gap between business, government, civil society, is that something you can tackle?
Well,
we can do that offline during the cocktail.
Yes.
Ali?
Apps. I don't think that you sell apps, really. Apps don't have a price. You make money from apps only when they start getting used. So you can develop all the apps you want. They can be as exciting as they want to be, but if nobody's using them, their value is zero. So you have to find a way of putting on a platform where they can be used. Then on being used, you can get some sense. They're used by a million people. You can make millions of money. But you have to be able to get them on that platform. And that is where you need people with money and access to these platforms to partner with you. So once you have your platform, you have to find people to believe in that platform, in that app, to help you get it onto the platform. This is not easy. This is like putting it on Android platform, putting it on iOS platform, putting it on Windows platform, putting it on TV, on Google. It requires money. It requires access to those platforms. Most app developers
don't have that. But Ali, are we not chasing our tails?
No, just a minute.
So I just wanted to demystify. You don't develop an app. I see a lot of people coming to me, say, I've developed an app. Can you give me money for it?
Okay, yes. Okay, fine. So let's come back to the issue because this is what you were saying, that it costs money. There's weak IP protection. You go to unscrupulous people who say your app is worthless, and then someone gave the example of business people who then develop a business around the app. How do you protect the person who's innovating?
Let's assume for a moment you have gone to an ethical business person who can help you put you on the platform. Well, the first thing they're going to do is to secure its IP with you as the developer. So you go to them, you have to sign a contract that I own a piece of this, you help me secure it, you'll own a piece of it, and then we take it to a platform it can be used, I'll get a certain amount of revenue. It's like music, it's like everybody, everything else. This is not new. But I wanted to also be fair to governments, and by talking about an example of what governments can do and why they should do this more, there's a strategic involvement of government in this space that is badly needed. 15 years ago, there was no fiber optic cable on the eastern seaboard of Africa. It was completely dark. It was not connected to the rest of the world by fiber optic cable. We were using satellite. Banks will tell you how much it was costing them to communicate. All of us were having a hard time. Our internet speeds were the lowest in the world. How did the cables get built? And they're built in a flurry. It's only when African governments realized that actually they could play an enabling role. My company, Zuku, owns a share in the Teams cable. But the Teams cable, although it was promoted by private sector, it could not be built by private sector because a cable is like a road. You don't make money off it. So the government of Kenya, however, underwrote the project. They said, okay, it makes sense to us. We'll pay for it. And after it was paid for it, they then split it up in bits and pieces and gave it back to private sector, each to buy the capacity we pay for. Okay. And with that, EC was built. Also, it's a collaboration of the incumbent telecom companies that are owned by governments in Africa. And then a private company like Seacom came and others. And all of a sudden, not only is Africa connected on the east, but internet speeds have gone up, costs have gone down, and apps are being developed. So that was one intervention in a couple of years. Can you imagine if African governments could continue identifying opportunities where they could play an enabling role and to make this economy actually work?
Can I just add? I'm actually in support of what Ali has just said.
We have aliens in the room. Just give us a minute.
Okay. Ali has just given you financial advice for free. And maybe that is this is the area that you're saying governments need to play from.
Thank you.
So Ali has just given you financial advice for free. It's called revenue share. You can make money in the continuously all your life off your app instead of selling it to a businessman at a specific one-time cost. But the whole thing and the whole discussion that's going on in the room is this aspect of needing to advise our young people and the innovators on legal issues and on business issues. And clearly this is a space that government can play.
Government or private sector, so that you can have not just a hackathon, but workshops around regulation. So your question was weak laws, Esther.
Yeah, and it's a question I want to share with Artie, I think, because she probably has more of the specialist information than I do. But I will say this on the question around valuation of your apps. There was a dot-com bubble, and then it bust. And it bust because of valuations of things that, you know, in the end didn't monetize or become useful. So I agree with the gentleman here. But allow me to pass the question, I think, to Artie around what
definitely
can you do.
Definitely dodged. Yeah. Okay, Artie, will you take it up?
Yeah, I mean, I think, you know, the first thing is, these days, there's no excuse for governments not to have access to, you know, other people's legislation. You know, you don't always have to try and, yeah, you can actually copy-paste somebody else's if it's going to work for you. So, you know, again, we're constantly encouraging governments to look at legal research tools and say everything from bribery and corruption through to intellectual property, through to, you know, I mean, everything can, you know, if it's going to apply to you, if it's relevant to your circumstances, just use what's already been...
I think the question had more to do with the attitude of the private sector, that in the space of weak laws...
Yes.
Let's take the example of Kenya, for instance. We've been grappling with corruption. And recently, the private sector said, okay, fine, and we'll draft an anti-bribery bill, and we'll go ahead and declare our wealth. And hopefully, that will start a chain reaction in terms of, you know, corruption, fighting corruption.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, there's always two, you know, it always takes two to tango. And I think if the private sector in Kenya, which has always taken the lead, and if the private sector in Kenya in this case continues to take the lead and says, you know, we'll start, you can follow government, you know, great, let's do it that way. In other countries, it might be the government starting. So I think, you know, whatever works, you know, go for it. You know?
Esther, you want to come back?
It's a hard question. It's a difficult question. And the way I would answer it is this way. Yes, so IP laws are weak, but there is a body of law around contracts, right? There is a body of law around many other things that where you could seek legal redress, for example. If the worst comes to the worst, you can sue, and you don't just have to sue on intellectual property laws, I don't imagine. You can sue purely on, I have a contract, we have an agreement, how can this work profitably? But then... before you get to there, I would argue that part of the role of the youth and everybody else is to understand they're not part of another sector. They're part of the private sector. It is up to them to also provide, you know, useful information or useful steps forward or work profitably with the people, their counterparties across the table, to come up with agreements or understandings or directives or to engage beneficially with things like the ICT Authority, the Telecommunications Commission, the Central Bank, in order to come up with a body of work that helps to actually protect everybody that's playing in the space. That's what I would say.
Okay, and then we come to the legal mind in the room. Simon.
Well, I think the question was, what is the private sector doing to address the deficiencies of data protection laws,
yes,
right?
Yes.
And
but if you can speak to the, you know, weak laws in general.
Well, I think the honest answer is that the private sector is doing as little as possible, and in fact, the private sector is exploiting existing weaknesses in data protection law as a business model. I mean, if you look at Facebook, right? Now, in the African context, I think the private sector is probably. Is far behind where it would be in places like Europe and the EU, where they're actively lobbying to try and get positive outcomes in TTIP or the rules that will replace safe harbor. But I'm actually quite skeptical as to what the role of the private sector should be. I mean, this is a job for governments, and this is a job for governments in the sense that the primary motivation should be to protect citizens. And so it's really a space for, yeah, I mean, there's a space for private sector to perhaps advise, but it's actually a space where civil society needs to be more active, right?
Are you not contradicting yourself? Because you asked government to get out of the way. You took exception to local content laws.
I'm quite surprised by my fellow panelists, because I think, you know, there's this overemphasis on what solutions governments can provide in supporting the growth of the digital economy, and an underemphasis on the role of what the private sector could be. And I think, I've worked in a lot of developing countries, including in Africa, and my sense is that government is not necessarily part of the solution to a sector like this. If you look in India, for example, one of the reasons why it was able to become so competitive in the programming sector and in the business process outsourcing sector is because the government was just so far behind in regulating, and so all the dysfunction was sort of focused on agencies like customs and the manufacturing economy, whereas the digital economy managed to grow because government just hadn't caught up with it.
And
right?
I think
The look on Ali's face is priceless, because you're thinking about the app developer who's not the programmer, who's not getting many...
And on that app question, I mean, the guy asked, how much do I price this thing? And the honest answer is, look, there's a market price for what you're providing, and there's also a price at which you're not willing to do it. Now, I've commissioned a couple of apps, and I was having this conversation with Andrew the other day about what they paid for this fantastic app that they have for the TDS, and the answer seems to be anywhere between sort of $5,000 and $10,000, right?
depends. Honestly, on an international market.
That one is a cocktail with free drinks. We can batter that one out. But Ali, you're going to come in and then Artie?
No, I really have to take Simon to task. I mean, his own company, Huawei, has made lots of money in Africa working almost exclusively with governments. In my own country, Tanzania, has spent, I think, in excess of $1 billion in the last 5 years building terrestrial fiber optic cables that are built by his company. And why is the government of Tanzania doing it? It's to enable ICT to take off. It's to enable itself to be able to use ICT.
But if they didn't do that,
the cost, it would just not happen. We would use outdated technologies. We would not be able to have a lot of people participating. So I think that much as it's expensive, much as it is seen by many as wasteful, but for me it has allowed a lot of people to build businesses off the back of that infrastructure.
RT?
So I think we should not double speak here.
RT?
I was just going to say, you know, the digital economy should ideally be borderless. And I think what governments really need to be careful about doing is not imposing restrictions such as privacy and localization rules and cyber requirements. I mean, there are countries that have tried this and it doesn't really work. If you sort of force if a company is collecting data in that country and you force it to keep that data in that country and you put restrictions on transmitting that data outside, I mean, that then starts negating global business. It starts becoming very expensive to have a copy of data in one place when, in fact, you might want to be aggregating your data and having it in some cheaper data center halfway across the world. And I think, trade negotiations do need to include commitments to the free flow of data. You know, how else are we ever going to have big data analytics? How else are we going to solve problems around disease if we're not aggregating this data, et cetera?
But I think there's definitely a role for government where the private sector is not going to step up. So when you're talking about building the backbone infrastructure, clearly government has to step up, and we've seen this in countries where we have national broadband plans. But for the digital economy as a whole, I mean, it's so market-driven, and there's such a market dynamic there. I think government and companies like Huawei can collaborate when it comes to enabling the underlying technologies, but not promoting what the economy that then is created on top of those enabling infrastructures. Okay. I think it's about you can have an ideological discussion about what the role of government is, and then reasonable people can disagree. But my sense is that you really only need governments to intervene when you see that there's a market failure. And building backbone infrastructure is clearly an area where there is a market failure. Nobody's going to do it unless the government steps up.
Okay, we can take that conversation elsewhere. We have just about 10 minutes to go. And so rather than coming to the floor, the point of this discussion was to establish whether a digital Africa really does exist, and I think we've done that. In fact, a report, I'm not sure who put this out, said that the iGDP, the contribution of the internet to GDP in Africa, is just over 1% against almost 4% for the developed world. But countries like Senegal are in the high...
McKinsey,
yes. But countries like Senegal are on the higher end of that spectrum. And so if our job here is to try to support that, create the environment for digital trade to thrive, what sort of policies should we be considering? You have come up with procurement, intellectual property, harmonization of financial systems, the regulatory framework, raising awareness. Is there anything else that we have missed out as you wind up, make your final thoughts, that we should be thinking about as we drive Africa's digital economy forward? Artie? Let's start with Simon and then end with Artie.
No, I just thought it was very interesting what one of my panelists said about corruption. I don't want it to come out on record that Huawei promotes corruption or anything like that, but I remember reading a fascinating chapter in a book by, I think it was Alan Beattie that wrote it, and it was called False Economy, and he talks about corruption. And so you have an economy, he compares economies like Korea and India. Korea was a very corrupt place to do business, but there was only one bunch of guys that you had to pay off, and it was the ruling party. In India, on the other hand, corruption is endemic, and it just suffocates business. So in many economies, corruption just acts like a tax. And in other places, it really stifles all economic activity. So you have to take a more nuanced approach to what corruption is. Sure, corruption's bad, but it doesn't necessarily have to be painted with one single brush. That was just something that I picked up when you were talking about corruption. Because I've lived and worked in a lot of places where there's a lot of corruption, and I can see that you know, there are different degrees of it and it has different economic impacts.
Okay, Esther, anything else that we need to be considering?
Yeah, I think to pay serious attention to what the future Africa will look like, there's a huge demography here that's going to be youthful, that's going to demand even more in terms of digital goods and services. A lot of the companies that we do business with are doubling and tripling their investments here in order to be able to serve the consumer that is coming out of university and coming out of school. And so I would argue that the other thing people need to pay attention to, governments need to pay attention to, is, you know, allocating resources, national budgets, to make sure that they are investing now for what is going to be a very digitally driven, heavy demand future.
Okay. Ali.
Just a message to the young people. People keep talking about the African youth as if they're just maybe a small, tiny minority of our population. We forget almost 80% of the population of Africa is young people, and by that, 35 years and below. So it kind of bothers me or worries me when I keep getting questions from young people. What are you going to do for the youth? What are you going to do for us? What kind of questions? So many questions thrown at us to answer. We don't have those answers. I think the young people should just go out and change Africa. When I was starting out 28 years ago and setting up a computer company in Tanzania, we had a law that made ownership of a computer a treasonable crime. To own a computer, you had to get a permit from a very obscure department somewhere in the Ministry of Finance. And that is how I imported my first computer if I came back from studies abroad. And I said, this is a stupid law. So I went and sat down with government, we have to get rid of this law. They said, which law? The law that prevents people from owning a computer. And most people didn't even know the law existed, but the law was there. You just faced it the moment you had a computer in customs. And because nobody was importing computers, the whole of the country didn't know about it. So that law was removed through my intervention. To go change the world, don't ask us, because you are the ones that this Africa is all about. You are the ones that laws are being made for. So participate in making them, participate in changing them if they're stopping you, and force your government to spend money where it needs to be spent. Don't ask us. We don't have the answers.
Philip. Philip, do you have any answers?
It's always a challenge to speak after Ali has spoken. It's almost like he was in my mind. Okay. Anyway, Yeah, just in support of what he has said, we all have to take responsibility, especially when it comes to innovation. So we are educated enough to be able to develop applications and innovations just like anyone else in the world. But the same tools that we're using to access information can also train us on how to model our businesses. We don't have to wait for somebody to come to buy what we've developed. You can actually market it online and sell it abroad and export. So we need to take responsibility. From a government perspective, what we would be asking the key stakeholders who are in negotiations, if there is one thing from an ICT perspective we would want them to change, is please review the laws that need to enable the digital economy. Review the tariffs, review the barriers, and seriously strengthen the IP laws or the contracting laws around how innovations are managed. Thank you.
I think I'll just end by saying, changing the dynamic slightly and say digital economy in terms of information flow and making sure that the people that need that information have access to it and are able to act on it. And I think that goes from everything from, you know, if you notice things in your supply chain that are illegal or unethical, how do you make sure that information gets to the right people? If, you know, there's a whole illegal parallel trade here in Kenya around drugs which are clearly marked only for sale in India, you know, and if that customs officer was able to see that the, you know, the, compare the owner of the trademark has not actually allowed that person importing those drugs to import those drugs, then, you know, that's one problem you can remove. So I think, you know, just getting information out there in the hands of people that need it, and then using that information, I think is extremely important. It's part of the digital economy.
Okay. Very quickly, let me get your just by yay or nay. This is an article that talks about Africa's mobile revolution and some factors to consider. Developing long-term plans based on geography, because we are 54 countries at, you know, at different levels, so we're agreeing on that. You've talked about working for social good, and that, I think, came very strongly from you, Philip. Catering to the young demographic, you've all talked about that. But being mindful of disruptive technology, because, you know, this is a young continent and we evolve quite fast. Is that something that you would also add to the pile of things that we should be addressing? Okay, so thank you very much for your time. Ladies and gentlemen, your panel, please give them a warm round of applause.